according to Luke, the 4th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing at all during those days, and when they were over, he was famished. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become a loaf of bread." Jesus answered him, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone." Then the devil led him up and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And the devil said to him, "To you I will give their glory and all this authority, for it has been given over to me, and I give it to anyone I please. If you then will worship me, it will all be yours." Jesus answered him, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil took him to Jerusalem and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to protect you, and on their hands they will bear you up so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, "It is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test." When the devil had finished every test, he departed from him until an opportune time. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Like Jesus is being tempted to act more than human. it does sound like he's being tempted to use his divine nature for the wrong reasons to make himself seem even greater. But upon examining this story a little more closely, it seems he's also being tempted with something else. He's being tempted to subvert, to undermine, to undo his human nature. He's being tempted to also be less than human. He was being tempted not to live up to his calling to be a human being, to use his God-given gifts and responsibilities. If Jesus had turned that stone into bread, yes, it would have been a divine act, but it would have broken his 40 days of not having food and learning how to fast as a human being. By doing this, he wouldn't have lived up to his humanity and the human's ability to devote time to God through fasting. If Jesus had jumped off the top of the temple and the angels had caught him, yes, he would have been using his divinity, although wrongly, but he would have failed to live life as a human being, and he would have therefore acted like less than human. See, this is the whole thing about Jesus. He is divine, but he is also human. And while on earth he was called to live the life of humanity, he was called by God to live as a human being so that he might identify with us in all of our joys and all of our sorrows, in our celebrations and our times of mourning, in those times that we laugh at unexpected jokes, in those times that we're called to experience the excitement of seeing new children enter the world, and to know the trouble and pain of attending a friend's funeral. Jesus is not only divine, he is also human. And we don't say that he was human just to try to make it make a little more sense. He was human too. He was not God walking around just dressed up as a human being with Halloween or something, with humanity as an illusion. He was fully human as well as divine. He lived it and it was real. So if Jesus had escaped his hunger by performing a miracle, if he would have done this, he would have not experienced the reality of human life. And if he had escaped the reality of gravity by having angels catch him, he would not have experienced the reality of the human life. If he had worshipped the devil to get the power over nations of the earth, he would have failed to live out the call to be a human being and experience that life as one who is supposed to worship the one true God and only this God. It would appear to be temptations to be more than human. Jesus was also being tempted to be less than that. But when we take a step back and think about it, isn't that really what's going on when we are tempted too? Doesn't temptation normally express itself by trying to convince us to be less than we are? Aren't we normally tempted to ignore our responsibilities and our callings as humans? Aren't we normally tempted to try to escape the limits and the confines of the human life? When we're tempted to work less than we should and try to get away with being a little lazy, is that really a temptation to be more than human? It doesn't sound that way. When we're tempted to put all of our trust in wealth and possessions that we have, is that really an attempt to be rich and more than human? Or is it really an attempt to skirt our need to be active and productive and supportive and take part fully in this human life? When we are tempted to have the nicest things and the shiniest things and the newest things and the coolest things and the smallest things and the largest things, whatever that temptation is it really an attempt to live larger than life and be like God? Or is it truthfully an attempt to fill empty part of our lives with the first thing we can find because we already feel less than fully human? When we search our hearts, and be honest with ourselves and ask ourselves why we are so easily tempted into bad situations or actions that we know are not going to lead us down a good path, we might discover that many of these temptations come from fears of our own inadequacy, fears of not being up to the job, from feeling that things are missing in our lives that would make us and feel like we're just less than we are. Don't our temptations try to make us feel less than human? You know, just like with this story, the devil is well practiced in tempting us in this way. Let's not forget that the devil has had thousands of years more practice than we've had in resisting. And one of the ways that the devil often tempts us to be less than human is by tricking us to be afraid of what's least possible and to be tempted to act in the way that's least necessary. C.S. Lewis, the Christian author who wrote The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe and many other books, he commented on this. He said that we're tempted to be afraid of what's least likely. He explained that in this way, we're walking down a road and we're so afraid of falling down the ditch in this side that we wind up wading in the ditch on the other side. Or put differently, he told about how you might be on a big ocean cruiser crossing the Atlantic and it runs into an iceberg and the ship goes down and you're swimming towards a lifeboat and suddenly you're terrified that you're going to get caught on fire. See, I think that's how it happens in our own time as Christians, too. We are so afraid of not being human enough that we wind up undoing and avoiding our humanity altogether. But there's always a solution when it comes to Jesus, when he points this problem out to us. And here is the solution. God does call us to be human. God did create us as human beings, and we remember that when God created us and created creation, God said, it is very good. We are here for a reason. We don't have to be afraid of living out our human lives to the fullest, even when there's faults and fumbles and failures on the way, as long as we are trying to do it in the service of God. And we don't have to run away from our lives in pursuit of all sorts of gadgets and cool things. We are called to live as human beings who just do the service of God, who love God and one another. Not a single person in this room is an accident. It doesn't matter how we got here or what our parents were thinking or whatever else, nobody is ever an accident. You know, the thousands of foster children that we deal with, thousands through Lutheran Social Services in Michigan, so often they think, well, I'm a mistake. Somebody told me I'm a mistake. No, they're not. They are children of God, and they are part of our family. Not just our family at LSSM, but our family here and in congregations across the state. Nobody is an accident. We don't have to then try to escape life because God has put us here for a purpose. Jesus knew what his purpose was, and he followed it boldly. And that's what gave him strength in resisting temptation. His call was simple, but pretty profound. He was to die on the cross for our sake and to rise from the dead for our sake. This allowed him to be knowingly driven to do the unthinkable, willingly be crucified. Let's not forget that the word excruciating comes from the word crucified. But we know that what he went through and the pain and torment that he went through, he knew too, it all had a purpose. Knowing that he was going to make all things new. Knowing that he was doing it for all of us. And when we too have discovered our purpose, even if there are struggles and torments along the way, we find God's strength to make it through those difficult situations. To find strength to look back at that temptation and try to resist. To find clarity during those confusing times. We do not have to run from the human life. It is a blessing that we can embrace because we know that God has great plans for us. So I do encourage you, take time to figure out what that purpose is and pray about it and ask God where your life should be headed. Because we can push back. Jesus will fill us with strength in allowing us to say no to those things to which we need to say no, just like he did, and yes to those things that we never thought we were capable of doing. Now, one of the reasons that I personally am so grateful to be serving in the call that I'm in right now with the people of Lutheran Social Services in Michigan is because I see people on a daily basis who have that strength, who know how to say yes to the right things and no to the others. They know that we are here for a purpose, and that this purpose involves expressing the love of Jesus in the world. This same Jesus who walked in our shoes, experienced the human life, endured temptation, and gave his life for all of us so that we might have life too. In fact, this really is the mission of Lutheran Social Services. It's simply this: serving people as an expression of the love of Christ. It's that simple, yet that profound. Serving people as an expression of the love of Christ. And when I say we, I don't just mean us in the 50-some LSSM offices across the state. LSSM is Lutheran Social Services of Michigan for short. When I say us or we, I'm including everybody in this room. I'm including people in congregations across the Lower Peninsula, and not just Lutheran ones now. Presbyterians and Methodists and Episcopalians and some Jewish synagogues and some other communities are all getting on board behind this desire to serve people so people would know that God loves them. You know, this is one of the few things that really shocked me. I didn't quite grasp when I first entered into this call about 8 or 9 months ago. I didn't quite realize just how much LSSM is part of our church. First of all, the two bishops of the Lower Peninsula sit on our board or have seats on our board. LSSM is part of our church. A few other things about us too, and again, about all of us here. LSSM is the largest faith-based nonprofit in the state of Michigan with 1,900 employees, and it's part of our church. We are the largest private adoption and foster care agency in the state of Michigan. We created new homes for almost 400 children last year, and it's part of our church. We are the largest refugee resettlement organization in Michigan, fourth largest in the nation, and part of our church. This is what we are all doing together. In fact, last year alone, we served 18,375 people. So when somebody asks you, well, what's the church doing to change the world? We served 18,375 people through this one arm of the church alone. Because it's not about us. It's about resisting the things again of this world that tell us, well, focus your time on something that doesn't matter as much. But we say no. All together here, we can serve people as an expression of the love of Christ and do it powerfully and do it effectively in a way that this world will begin to reflect what God has truly called it to be. I'm not going to go on and on about all the things, but we have senior living communities throughout the state. We have places for people with disabilities, in-home health care, and we have 87 adults in special homes for people with developmental disabilities. Again, the list goes on and on. We all do this because we know that we have a purpose serving with one another. So I want to say thank you, because I know some families here personally, sometimes as groups, you get behind these efforts with your time and your talents and your treasure. But I want you to know you are making a massive difference in this world. You are partnering with us so that people would know what God's love is. You are helping us serve people as an expression of the love of Christ, and that is leading them to better lives. Amen.